The following video contains spoilers. We suggest watching the episodes alone in the dark. Hello, Wolfpack! We're back! And today, we take a look at one of the Twilight Zone's most popular tales ever, The After Hours. The 1980s remake of The After Hours. Yeah, seriously. Rather than taking a look into the iconic classic Twilight Zone tale, we're jumping right into the remake of it instead. You see, the upcoming third Twilight Zone reboot, hosted by Jordan Peele, has recently been announced, which inevitably means that remakes on the original's greatest tales of suspense will soon follow. But did you know that the latest incarnation of the Twilight Zone was not the first reboot to attempt a remake on many of the franchise's best episodes? The process of remaking Twilight Zone tales has been done by both the 80s reboot and the 2000s reboot, both shows being absolutely dreadful at it. Ordinarily, I'd start with the original first, but I'm going to do something new on the channel, a compare and contrast analysis. Meaning that I will review the polarizing remake while also discussing how the original story did things. And considering that terrible remakes are a commonplace problem in modern media, it's only fitting that we finally do our first attempt at critiquing a failed remake of a beloved story. Now, to be clear, the 80s Twilight Zone reboot was considered one of the best, if not the only good reboot series, to ever come close to the classic Gen 1 Twilight Zone's greatness. However, they did have one huge weakness. Their remakes sucked. The show's original tales were much more well-received compared to their tries at recapturing the glory days of the old show, but rumor has it that this one is one of the more tolerable remakes. But is that belief true or not? Well, that's what we plan to find out. So grab yourself some popcorn and drinks, because we're about to take a trip back into the Twilight Zone. Was this remake a perfect model of the 80s Twilight Zone's awesomeness? Or is it a hollow block of wood simply dressed up nicely? Let's find out. This is my review on the remake tale, The After Hours. So, our episode opens up at an outlet mall bus stop where we meet our main character, an energetic, peppy college woman named Marcia, who's played by Jadzia Dax from Star Trek Deep Space Nine. Oh yeah, the Twilight Zone got a Star Trek hero to play a protagonist in their horror story. Again. That's a good sign, since usually the actors on Star Trek can act very well, so the remake did get somebody good to play the new version of this character. However, you'll soon see that even having somebody as cool as Mr. Worf's girlfriend on this show can't save the remake's writing. Apparently, this Marcia girl is entering the mall to do some last-minute shopping for a gift that's somehow only available at this exact store. What are the odds? Alas, she's unable to enter because some security guard tells her that they're closed. Okay, it doesn't end there. But trust me, that would have been the good ending for her. Instead, another security guard comes by, telling Marsha that they're closed. But she says she'll only be in for a minute, so the guard goes, "Oh, okay, I'll let you in then." And she ventures through the closing mall, but then we see a mannequin coming to life and watching her. Wow. Wow. First 2 minutes, and the remake already spoiled the supernatural characters. Seriously, remake? Seriously? Yep, in the original tale, the supernatural characters are revealed to be living intelligent mannequins who try to get Marsha. A brilliant twist that was saved for the halfway point of the story, not the opening scene. The story wants to drop a bomb on the audience with the living mannequins as well, but the fact that they blow their ammo so early gives away any chance for greater shock value. This was one of the best twists in the Twilight Zone, and you chose to reveal it early? Come on, reboot. Don't fall into the same trap as the G3 Twilight Zone. You're better than that. As brilliant as a twist can be in a story, there is a major difference between involving foreshadowing building up to it and just plain spoiling the whole plot point. So Marsha explores the cool retro mall where the director shows off how cool their set is. "Wow, this mall sure is big. Hope nobody gets a Scooby-Doo chase scene here." As she rides up an elevator, Marsha spots a creepy stranger watching her from afar. But naturally, she totally ignores him and heads off to a toy store to buy her friend a doll. Ooh, I sure hope she buys worry dolls to make the 2000s reboot go away. We also get numerous scenes of the mall workers warning Marsha that the place is closed, so she should go home. But like a moron, she persists in her quest to buy a $2 doll anyway and risks getting locked in the mall overnight. In the original, Marsha was locked in the mall overnight too because the workers thought she was passed out after fainting at the sight of something scary, but they left her sleeping in an office upstairs under the idea that they would come back for her once she slept a while. In the remake, she gets trapped in the mall thanks to her own stupidity. What a clever reimagining! Anyways, she makes it to the scary toy store, where we then meet a creepy saleswoman. In the original tale, this woman was eerie, stoic, and so ominous that you vaguely got the impression that she had it out for our main character, but you never figure out why until the final twist. Here, she's an over-the-top, ambiguously insane nutjob who can't even go a single sentence without sounding like she's evil. While I do like the G2 Twilight Zone for its masterful horror scenarios, the fact that the remake takes the original's insanity up to the 11 right in the first few instances kind of soils the atmosphere. The old After Hours had a very slow-paced build-up for the suspenseful and unnerving tone. It was a bit much, but it worked. This version escalates the whole setting right to the highest level instantly, leaving very little time to take it all in, preventing us from getting a deeper feel for it. Even the creepy shop in the original was scarier. In the old After Hours, this sales lady had a vastly empty shopping district that just felt unnerving from the isolation. Here, she owns a toy store with a million creepy dolls in it just to hammer in the fear power. In case you haven't gotten my point, subtlety is not this remake's strong suit. The reboot tries way too hard to make this scene so scary that it ironically becomes less scary compared to the older version. The feeling of Marsha being alone and in danger from the strangers is sacrificed by inserting in a lot more ominous people into what's supposed to be vast emptiness. Anyways, Marsha purchases a rip-off Cabbage Patch doll from the clearly unstable sales lady, who goes ominously into the back room to get it for her. Then a boy jump scares Marsha, where he and his mother reveal that they know her name somehow, despite never meeting her before. But they claim it was just a lucky guess. However, we soon get this odd scene.
Apologize for disturbing the nice woman and we'll go.
I'm taking you with you when you go. Please. I'm ready.
Excuse us.
Remember this? Marsha tells the creepy sales lady about the odd family, but the customers vanish without a trace. Then, for little to no reason at all, Marsha tells the saleswoman her whole life story about struggling to find a job, a home, a car, and earning some extra money, as if she never had any of them before in her life at all. Now, to be fair, this exposition scene does cover up a few plot holes regarding the original, but the remake actually cleverly ties the scene in to their own story as well, and makes the twist more stronger. I will admit that they do a decent job with this foreshadowing moment compared to the last one, so congrats, Reboot, you win some bonus points for your logic. But as she exposits her backstory, she spots the creepy stranger outside, where out of nowhere, the sales lady then goes completely nuts and starts creeping on Marsha. Yeah, with little to no lead-in, she goes from slightly insane to full-on assertive bad guy in a few minutes. Great pacing, guys! The saleswoman starts asking Marsha questions about her life, but for some reason, Marsha can't remember her past, as if she has no memory of her childhood, where the creepy lady starts shouting to Marsha that her whole life is a lie. This was a plot twist that was saved for the end of the story, but this reboot wants to end as fast as it began. Then, the scary lady tries forcing Marsha to stay with her, before unsurprisingly our hero bolts off in fear. Well gee, it's almost as if creeping on a woman and shouting how her whole life is a lie was a dumb idea to win them over. Again, in the original story, this was done a lot better. The sales lady was a jerk, but one thing that made her compelling is that she seemed like she knew more about Marsha than what she was talking about, and the bizarre setting made her appear otherworldly. But heck with that, let's turn her into Diet Norma Bates. However, as Marsha runs away from the scary lady, she bumps into the creepy stranger, who reveals that he's a mannequin. Which was something we already knew, because we saw him partially frozen in place in the introduction. Again, the mannequin reveal was done 1,000 times scarier in the original, because you don't see it coming, and it's done in a way to make the viewers question the protagonist's sanity, suggesting that the dummies in the mall might or might not be real at all. But nope, here they're all real, and just as evil as Silent Hill monsters. This creepy stranger is most likely the remake's version of the creepy elevator operator, but they never exactly tell us who he is or even give him a name, so I'm just going to call him Mr. X, because that's pretty much who he's supposed to be. He's just a physically imposing supernatural stalker trying to get our main character for an unknown goal. That's it. So, Mr. X chases Marsha throughout the area, but of course she's locked inside the mall. Suddenly, she sees that even the security guards are all mannequins too! Wait, all the guards are dolls too? So where the heck are the real mall cops? Do the evil mannequins just pose as the mall cops to take control of the place during nightfall, or are there any real mall guards watching over the place? Do the mannequins just take up jobs in the mall to pose as human beings, or do they own the mall too? This episode honestly raises even more questions than the original tale did. Where the heck is the mall security force here?
Sure hope this Acme kid works.
Gosh, that cheese looks good. Think I could grab it before that anvil hits?
I don't know, Chief. It's 1,000,000 to 1.
I like those odds.
But then, just like in the original, all the dolls call to her. And most of their dialogue in this consists of the mannequin screaming Marsha's name.
No! 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 Marsha, Marsha, Marsha!
Is it me, or did that mannequin sound like Sam Elliott?
Marsha!
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 Marsha Bods!
Also, this is just a minor nitpick, but the mannequins in this aren't that creepy looking. A ton of the dress models in this look more funny than scary. I mean, look at the mannequins that surrounded Marsha in the original tale. They look kind of silly, but many of them do look like actual models you'd find in a department store. Just look at them!
And why are you wearing that ski mask? Because you're not skiing!
Here, what the heck are we even looking at? It looks like disco X-Wing pilots with mechanical wax lips. Who even puts wax lips on a mannequin anyway? I know this was made back in the 80s, but by today, it feels like a desperate attempt to make the models scarier than the original, when really, not that much needed to be inserted into this. I'll give them credit that the show wants to make things scarier, but all the close-ups on the scary faces feel almost as much, if not more, as the Haunting Hour's scary face close-ups. Close-ups on the mannequin faces don't make them scarier. It just feels forceful, since we already knew that the mannequins were all alive from the start. Speaking of nightmare fuel, the rest of this episode goes like this. Marsha gets one long Scooby-Doo chase scene running around the whole mall while Mr. X and the creepy sales lady pursue her, with a few more bonus shots of the mannequins looking scary. That's it. Half of this episode is just a long, long chase scene. To the show's credit, they do give us some decent nightmare fuel that does really look scary, but it goes by so fast and it gets glossed over so often that you'd be forgiven if you completely forget all these parts of the story. I do appreciate the scary imagery, and it does fuel a lot of potential fan theories, but ultimately, the show never does anything with it. Every time we get a gruesome-looking image, Marsha gets chased off by Mr. X again. It just feels like a wasted opportunity. How does Mr. X even keep finding her? Is he just using a magical mall map? In the old version, all of the mannequins shared the same magical floor of the department store, which they gathered at. But the new version wants to imply that the dummies just own the entire mall and see everywhere. It could be scary, but again, they spend most of the episode with this Scooby-Doo chase scene. And this is pretty much the formula for this entire chase scene. Marsha screams at something scary, runs away, and then we get a shot of some nightmare fuel. Rinse and repeat. Screaming, running, nightmare fuel. Screaming, running, nightmare fuel. Screaming, running, nightmare fuel. Again, the nightmarish imagery is good, but the sad thing is that it never gets addressed ever again. You see, you could include as much nightmare fuel in a story as you'd want, but it does have to tie into the story. Nightmarish scenes like this could be used to provide the supernatural forces or evil villains with some depth as unique characters, as it can give the viewer a warped look inside the mind of a deranged monster, or establish a feel of uneasiness for a villain. But here, the scary imagery barely links to Mr. X or any of his mannequin cohorts at all, and just comes across as scary for the sake of being scary. It's not the subtle mind-screw horror of the original, but rather in-your-face booga 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 jump scares. It's flashy, but there's no deeper themes or substance behind it all. Of course, the evil mannequins corner Marcia and tell her the truth. Marcia is actually a mannequin all along, and they were really her family just trying to bring her back home to the mall. She really lives with them here, and she just forgot her memories thanks to being in the outside human world for too long. Now, here's where we get the biggest change from the story. In the original, Marcia was also revealed to be a mannequin like them, but she forgot her memories because her exposure on the outside in the human world for over 1 month caused her memory loss and made her forget her true heritage. The mannequins were actually the good guys, and they were trying to help her remember who she really was. You see, the mannequins take turns visiting the outside world to experience what it's like being a normal human being. However, they must return to the mall since they'll eventually forget who they are and risk transforming into an abomination if exposed outside for too long. The creepy sales lady in the old one was so hostile to Marcia because it was her turn to go to the outside world, and Marcia refusing to readjust to the mall life was making her late for her own vacation. In the end, Marcia accepts her fate and ends on friendly terms with all the models, giving the audience a thought-provoking twist that our identity is something we must cherish, and that the people we see every day might not be who they appear to be on the surface. A very clever theme, and a conclusion that ends with our heroine finally happy. But on this version, the mall is a prison, and all the mannequins are being forced back inside against their will, while the guards only offer a brief chance for freedom to each of the dolls before dragging them all back into their places. Marcia escaped from them and refuses to go back. She knows this place is horrible, and she was trying to get away from her jailers, knowing that this would cause a problem in their society. All the mannequins asking her about the outside world, like the little boy, were prisoners who wanted her to free them as well, because the prisoners hate their place being trapped forever, while Marcia was free. Mr. X and the sales lady were chasing Marcia down, not to help her, but to force her back into her place. And yeah, this is where the remake fails to understand the old After Hours. It sacrifices the deeper themes and clever storytelling for generic horror. This isn't like the secret society and paranoia fuel of the old one, but instead, a very by-the-numbers slasher movie tale. The twist that this Marcia was an escaped prisoner sounds good on paper, but when you see the old tale, it feels slightly dumbed down, since she goes from a complex character with a complicated relationship to the mannequins to just a horror movie final girl. Not to mention, this twist makes our protagonist look like a total idiot. If Marcia was desperately trying to get away from this place, then why the hell didn't she move into a whole nother state to get away from these evil people? She says how she never wants to go back to her position at the mall, but rather than just screwing over the evil models and moving away, she absent-mindedly goes right back to the place she wanted to leave behind forever. I'm sorry, but this twist seems like an idiot plot. There are multiple ways to write around this, but the show never gives them, and in their attempt to make Marcia more complex, it accidentally makes her look foolish. I mean, if you were all trying to escape from a wicked place of evil, wouldn't you all try to get as far away as you possibly can? Not just get out of the building a mile out and start forming your new life within distance of the toxic death zone you tried getting away from. It just makes Marcia look so stupid. I'm sorry, guys, but they could have done much better. But let's wrap up. Mr. X and the Wrangler start turning Marcia back into a mannequin, really you style, and coerce her into coming back to them. Which raises the question, why the heck they didn't use this power sooner? But hey, we needed that chase scene. I'll grant them this, it's very nice body horror that feels on par with Lily D's magic, but what kind of brings it down is that the show hammers in how evil the mannequins are by making them sound like a deranged cult. The mannequins in the old version were ambiguous but proved to be ultimately good. Here, they just ham it up like Silent Hill cult members and close out as evil as possible. So Marcia freezes back, falls over, and the villains gloat evilly.
You had your turn to go out and experience the real world for a month. Now it's someone else's turn. It's only fair.
He's right.
Now we shall sacrifice her to our noble goddess, the magnificent Lily D. We then get to our twist ending. We see all the mannequins frozen back into place like Toy Story dolls, but now we see Marcia trapped forever with her doll family in doll form, as the narrator explains it all for us in his final monologue.
Now that's what I call sitting pretty.
Yep, Marcia is trapped forever. Happy nightmares. And that was the end to the 80s remake of the famous Twilight Zone adventure, The After Hours. How does it hold up? Well, despite my nagging, it was average. The After Hours remake is not the worst Twilight Zone reimagining I've ever seen, but sadly, it's not the greatest either. This episode was an average horror story. While it mends some of the plot holes of the original version, such as Marcia talking about her lack of human necessities and bringing up how unknown the world is to her, it is a very bare-bones version of the beloved classic. It strips away all the deeper themes and thought-provoking concepts to play it out as a simplified slasher story. While I do kind of like the idea that Marcia was an escaped prisoner and she never wanted to go back to her place at the mall, it turns the complex supernatural characters into generic bad guys and removes most of their redeemable qualities. It feels way too much like this remake was playing things safe and just making the morally gray characters simple good guys and bad guys, purging the tale of any thoughtful concepts and scary suspense. Now, there are some good things in this story, such as the very great nightmare fuel and decent special effects. I do honestly think the horror scenes in this episode work, since this show has proven that its strongest quality is the horror. However, much of my dislike for this episode stems from being a fan of the original. If you saw the old version of this classic tale, then you might be disappointed, because it guts a lot of the awesome parts. If you've never seen the original and go into this tale completely blind, then I think you might find it okay. Most of this episode is following the bare minimum concepts of the original before altering the twist ending and transforming an identity crisis tale into a horror story. I did like the chase scene a bit, but it dragged on for a while. Nothing awful, just a tad bit generic. The actors were okay, the setting was cool, the nightmarish imagery was great, and the ideas were interesting, but it was just a simple, safe, downgraded remake. So I give this episode a silver skull. Watching both versions of the After Hours back-to-back has made me realize what a great work of art the older version was in comparison. If you still like this, that's fine. It's not the worst remake ever made. Heck, I think the 2000s Twilight Zone still holds that honor. But I can't really say it's all that great, either. It's just a dumbed-down, generic horror tale that wants to be fairly entertaining, but finishes off just passable. I know it seems like we haven't shown the 80s remake in the brightest light, but trust me when I say that this reboot was not a horrible show. It was just very weak in the remakes department, but the show's original ideas were very awesome. The second After Hours story is only a plain model, dressed up in all flash, but with no substance. I don't really recommend it, due to the fact that this show has 100 other superior tales of suspense, and not even having Jadzia Dax in this episode could make it any better. Think about that. Remember to like, comment, share, and subscribe, or just tune in for more videos posted here on Wolf Entertainment. I'm your host, Catastrophe, and I hope to see you all next time. I wish you the best of luck. Cat, you wuss! It is nothing that I can't handle. No need to get that upset about it.
What do you mean, Thundercatter? Are you sure our buddy is okay? You have no way to see him on a line! Oh, this is terrible! Mechanicat might be dead! Who's going to come to my tea party?
Calm yourself, Pinky. I'm sure he's just fine. No need to look into it. I'm sure it's just an accident or a connection error.
Perhaps, or perhaps not. You've never been a reliable source of information, big cat liar. But you may be right for once.
Oh, glorious sub-commander, what do you propose we do? What do you think this means? Is the great Mechanicat truly gone?
I'm not entirely sure, Cat Tana, but if the Mechanicat has truly fallen in combat, then we must proceed with caution. It could be nothing of real issue, but it could be a problem we do need to check on.
Ooh, does this mean a road trip?
Yes, Pinky. In order to ensure the safety of the Negawolf Empire, we must check this out. Let's pay a visit to this Earth One.